Many programmers avoid to make immutable designs because of an unfortunate misunderstanding. At the core of that misunderstanding lies the belief that an immutable design is just immutable. That is far from true. An immutable design is immutable on the outside. When you invoke a method or a function, nothing will change, not a single bit will change in memory, in objects that you can reference. Still, on the inside, especially when things become hairy, there might be a lot of mutation that will eventually warrant speed, the performance of an immutable algorithm. I will now show you a short demo where the performance will be at stake and the performance of an generally immutable algorithm will be saved by a well-measured mutation inside of it. Still, on the outside, everything will remain deeply immutable. Join me and see. Here I have an immutable record modeling a work item in some planning software. Let's introduce the problem we will be solving. I'm creating the whole bunch of work items. The result of all this construction is a single object, which is a request to implement a feature in a software project. We need to implement an operation, expand, that will expand one work item into a sequence of all the work items that we must complete so that this work item is complete. That means to recursively unfold its prerequisites. An expanded work item is that work item followed by all its prerequisites expanded themselves, but this might return duplicates of some work items, so I will eventually take the distinct of all the work items expanded this way. There it is, an immutable operation. It will change nothing when we invoke it on the calling end. Nothing will change. My design is fully immutable. And there you have it. 12 features, 12 tasks need to be completed. A harder request comes now. We need to sort these tasks in an order which warrants that we are always working on a task for which all prerequisites are complete. That is a typical project management request. How shall we implement that operation? That would be another immutable operation, this time on the sequence of work items. I will now implement this in a way that might surprise you. The execution order of a sequence of work items is to put 3 items first. Those are the items that have no pending prerequisites. And then to concatenate, look at this, all the work items except those that are free to start. That will be the sequence of all the items that are still waiting for something. Those items we need in the execution order now. There are 2 things missing here. The free to start method is missing, and also there is a bug here. This is a recursive function. We need a termination condition. In case that there are no items to process, we return an empty collection of items. Otherwise, we perform the full operation. This first case will ensure that my recursion will eventually unfold and complete. Now comes the free to start method. It is very easy to write. It is all the items where an item doesn't have any prerequisite in the collection of items or the sequence of items we still have. Look at this implementation. What do you say about it? It is 3 lines of code long. Do you know what is the corresponding implementation using, for example, graph algorithms, it would be like 20 or 30 lines of code long. I have 3 lines of code that does the whole job. That is how bare immutable design is implemented. It is incredibly simple. Unfortunately, it's not going to work well. I will transform this recursion into a lazy evaluated form so that you can see how the items actually appear on the output of this method. Back at the program CS, I will write an entire loop with the sorted items, and then I will run the application. The first part runs instantaneously, but the second one quickly gets into trouble, the performance trouble. My 3 lines of code do not perform well. Who would say? The greatest problem is that all the sequences produced by the recursive calls are lazy evaluated. The later steps are recalculating the entire history over and over again just to add one tiny addition to it. That is where mutability comes to the table. I will show you several techniques. I will first improve the expand method, which is easier to work with. The simplest solution is just to materialize each intermediate result into a list. Now, how come that I am using such a mutable collection in the middle of an immutable algorithm? Here is the obvious answer. This list is only visible on the stack inside this method. Nobody outside has a reference to it. And the entire result is an enumerable which hides the fact that there is a list behind it. All you can do with an enumerable is take the enumerator and iterate through it. And there is more. In an immutable design, all objects are values. You should be able to remember the result of a method once you calculated it and use it later again when the same input appears. That's what I'm doing here. I'm preparing a private implementation of the expand, which receives a dictionary that remembers which work item as the argument produces which list as the result. If the cache already contains the result for this work item, then just return that result. That is memoization. Otherwise, populate the cache with the complete calculation of the resulting list and return that result. The original expand, public expand method will be trivial this time because we will just call the private implementation and pass it the empty dictionary. This implementation remains immutable on the outside, and it will be blazingly fast because it will never calculate the same list again once it did it for a previous call. Yet, just as I promised, it is bursting with mutability on the stack, on the call stack. There are so many mutable operations inside the function, but on the outside, you will never be able to see that. Let's improve the getExecutionOrder method. I'm calculating free to start 2 times in every execution. I can fix that in no time by introducing a private method that receives the free to start sequence, and then the public method will just calculate that once and collect the results into a list. Mutation again. A very small portion of mutation is here. Can we apply memoization now? I have a better idea. the item prerequisites.any that satisfy that the work items contains that item, that is the culprit. If I had a quick method to calculate this operator, I bet the entire method would run blazingly fast. And I know the collection that is just right for that job. A hash set. The contains method of hash set returns in O of one time. At the very top, in the get execution order method, I will check whether the work item sequence is not a hash set, and if so, I will first collect the work items into a hash set and then invoke the get execution order recursively. Mutation in its full glory again. And I can't wait to see my application running. There you go. In a blink of an eye, I don't have a performance issue anymore. The next stop is the theory of algorithms. Implement those 20-30 lines of code for these two methods, expand and get execution order. Do them procedurally, fully mutable on the inside, but retain their simple immutable interface on the outside. And you will have an immutable implementation of those two operations, which violates no rules of immutable design at all, and yet work in the fastest possible way, because those would be the procedural implementations of the two algorithms.